And I hear the Savior say, and thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. As Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as paid it all to him I owe. My sin had left this crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. It's washed away. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Yes, he did.
Oh,
Jesus.
I still can't believe they let me build a wall there. I don't know where you want to be in a typhoon in the Philippines. I can tell you where you don't want to be. Anywhere near that wall they let me build. What a great trip and a great opportunity. I want to ask John to come up. This is John Wilson. John has been the team leader for Go Philippines. He went with us last year and got a great passion for the people of the Philippines. He obviously is great friends with Dan and Michelle. And when I asked him to go, I told him in advance that I really want you to pray about leading this team and this partnership. He has done a great job. He is one of those people, I told First Service, he's not like the donkey that is sat down that you have to drag to get something done. He's a thoroughbred in the gate that just is chomping at the bit to go and to do. And I have been so proud of him. I'm going to let him introduce his team and the folks that will be sharing this morning. So if you'll welcome John Wilson with me.
Good morning, church. It's always a challenge to try to do the same thing twice, but I'll try to do at least as good as I did the first service, and then, you know, maybe better. So if the rest of the team would come up, I really want you guys to be able to see the folks that were on this trip. I know we had a great many of them in the first service, but I think we still got quite a few in this service. I just want you to be able to see, you know, if you hear something, if you have questions, if you want to know what it was like, certainly a three-minute video doesn't explain it at all. As much as it's nice to look back at those pictures and remember, that doesn't cover it a bit. These are the people that you can ask. Feel free to pick their brains, talk about it. You might hear some things that you didn't want to hear about a typhoon, about a missed flight, about how hot it is eating food that has faces. But you're going to hear a lot of things about what the Lord did in the Philippines. And I said it in the first service and I'll say it again now. I mean, you saw the pictures, we did construction, but that was just the thing that got us there. That wasn't everything that happened on this trip. And that's why I'm excited for a couple of our team members to tell you about it. Cause we had 12 different people that went on this trip. We had 12 people that really didn't know each other for the most part at all, had, you know, ran across each other, knew who each other were, but really had no knowledge of each other. And what we came back was a family together, but also a family combined with our family in Christ in the Philippines. And it's just awesome to see the Lord move. So first I'd like to introduce Miss Lori Hetzel to tell you a little bit about her experience. So Lori, here you go.
All right. John 14:15 says, if you love me, you will obey what I command. And the commands I first thought of and our team thought of when I led devotion the first day were love one another and go make disciples of all nations. And that was really our purpose for the week. I had the privilege of leading our group that first morning. And I knew that if we were to accomplish our goal for the week, we had to work as a team. And that was kind of my focus. We were a team of 12. And like John said, we didn't know each other really well, and we were getting ready to work in a very small space. So we really needed to get to know each other pretty quickly. The day before we began our work, we went to Grace Baptist and attended service there. We were able to meet the members of the church. It's a small church, but it's a church that is, when you walk in, you immediately feel the Spirit. They love Jesus. They are passionate, and you can feel that when you walk in that room, and worshiping with them was a honor. It was just wonderful to see, okay, these are the people that we're working for this week. This is what we're doing. And whenever we went to, we were able to see the beginning of the nursery in the children's area that we were going to be building. And when I looked at that, I thought about Hepzibah, because that was exactly what we were doing. It was the same thing. Our churches are in a similar place. We need space for families here so that we can share the word of Christ. And that's exactly what they needed, too. They're a small church, but they have lots of children. They have lots of young adults. And they needed space to grow. And we were able that week to provide that for them, to start to build and to start to love on them so that they could essentially grow their church. They could have more people and they could reach more people for Christ. They had a lady there who was due. She's had her baby a couple of weeks ago. And they're rocking that baby in that nursery right now. They're able to use the space that we helped to provide. So basically, our purpose for that week was to be their building program. It was to show our love and commitment to them by being the hands and feet of Christ. And that was such a privilege for us to do. But in order to make this happen, we had to work as a team. And I shared this the first morning with our team. Les Steckel is the president of Fellowship of Christian Athletes. And he created the five C's of teamwork. And I shared that with our team. And I think it can do a ball team. It can be a team like ours. It can be a church. That if we followed these five C's, then we would be successful. So basically, the C's were communication, cooperation, contribution, commitment, and Christ. So that's what we needed to do. So we took those five C's to heart and embodied this vision as a team. 12 people that didn't know each other very well on October 15th came home as close friends and teammates on October 25th. We did this by working together, even when things didn't make sense, and figuring out how to do things, because the Filipino way of building is a lot different than the American way of building, and we had to do a lot of problem solving. When one person got frustrated when that happened, there was always somebody else to encourage and to help to problem solve. And everyone figured out their niche, and we committed to doing as much as we could to serve Grace Baptist and serve the surrounding churches. And at the end of each day, we were able to come together and thank God for what He was able to accomplish through us. I'm so grateful for the new friends both here and in the Philippines I've made on this trip, and it's forever changed me.
Thanks so much, Lori. I really appreciate you sharing that. So I got the pleasure to introduce another one of our team members, and I'm especially excited to do this introduction, because just like Aaron mentioned, going in March and really coming back with a hunger to help and to make a difference and to do something with our brothers and sisters in the Philippines, seeing the need, we came back from this trip with one of our team members saying, really being willing to step up and say, I see the vision there. I want to help lead our future partnership in the Philippines. And right now we're working on putting together a trip for April. So I'm super excited to introduce Jana Spruill, to have her tell you a little bit about her experience, but also to share the calling that she heard about our future partnership there in the Philippines. So.
Good morning. Let's talk about comfort zones. The funny thing about comfort zones, they don't mean much when you go on mission for God. So let me give you a few scenarios. Sharing your close personal space with strangers on a more than 12-hour flight while trying to sleep upright. Being hot, sweaty, absolutely filthy because of concrete, dust, and dirt. Trying various forms of manual labor that some of us would probably never try here at home. Being recruited to speak in front of the church congregation. I am not in my comfort zone. All right, but one thing I learned, and that this trip demonstrated to me, was that anything God calls me to do, or calls you to do, isn't going to be easy. It may be downright uncomfortable, but it's going to be worth it. It's going to be worth it because your actions are meant to glorify Him. It's worth it in a way that ends up blessing you. I played just a small role in helping build the addition onto Grace Baptist Church. But all of us, as a team, created a space for children to be taught the Word of God and for teachers to make disciples. We created a space that will further the kingdom of God. I want you to know that just because I've mentioned some things that may seem negative from the trip, the negative doesn't begin to outweigh the experience, the relationships that we formed and built on, not only with the team, but with the Philippines, the people of the Philippines, and the impact of sharing the love of Jesus with others. So the negative is not to discourage you. It's actually to make you consider how God can use you. With that said, we have an opportunity in late April to help approximately 30 churches of the on the island of Masbate run a youth camp for 300 to 400 children. They've done the camp before, but one of the things that stuck in my mind when Pastor Rex was telling us about it, and he's from one of the churches on Masbate, was that kids from each church would be served food based on what their home church could afford, what had been budgeted for their attendance. Can you imagine kids sitting side by side, some eating rice and beans or rice and fish, while others are eating a full meal complete with fruit and dessert? Some of the churches even apply for government loans for their kids to be able to attend. So here's an opportunity for us to continue our partnership in the Philippines, where we can not only offer financial support so that these kids can come to this camp, but we can participate in organizing the camp. So I'd like to encourage you to step out of your comfort zone and join us in April. Thank you.
Thanks, Jenna. Thank you so much, Jenna. I know this church. I know that we have a great many talented people who love children. I know that when we first were discussing the construction trip, I had a lot of people come to an interest meeting and were like, let me know when you're not doing construction and when you're ready to play with kids and love on them. So this is a great opportunity for us. We'll be holding an interest meeting next week after the second service, so on Sunday the 22nd. In the fellowship hall. I know that's really short notice. I apologize for that. We had it scheduled a few weeks out, but obviously with just getting to present this week, that gives you guys less notice. But if you feel that calling, if you feel interested, if you feel like, I just want to hear more, I want to know more, come and join us next week after the second service in the fellowship hall. Hear about it. See what the Lord says to you. You know, I shared this in the first service, and I can't remember if I led with this or if I closed with it, but when we met 6 weeks ago, you know, before we were getting ready to leave, and we went around the room, and I asked everybody, I said, why are you here? What is your purpose? What I expected to hear was, I got a lot of experience with construction. I'm great at, you know, projects. I love using my hands to show my love for other people. What I got was a room full of I don't knows. But not just I don't know. I don't know why I'm here. All I know is I couldn't say no. All I know is I got to a point where I continued to feel called, and I had no idea why, and I just could not say no anymore. I imagine that there's a lot of you guys that are here and heard Lori and Jana, have seen the videos, and have been trying to say no, but you're running out of reasons why. Join us. You know, feel free to join us for the interest meeting. Find out more about it. The last thing I'd like to say is that Dan and Michelle have set a date of February 1st to be there. I owe them a lot of thanks for opening up this partnership for the church. You know, if it hadn't have been for that trip back in March where we went to see his vision for this city, I don't know that we would be where we're at. And so I am very appreciative that that Hepzibah can continue to partner with the Philippines, but he's getting ready to be there. They're at 50% of their funding. So if you haven't yet given, know that there is still an opportunity for you to participate. You may never go, but there's an opportunity for you to help support. And a very minimal amount of money is what it takes. $20 a family from this church would get them there. $20 per family per month. That's a small amount of money for him to do a ministry across the world and for us to continue to have a great partner there in the Philippines. So you can go to skillsforchrist.org or you can go to the Church's eGiving website and give through there. But they are looking for your support. They need it. They've been traveling around to churches. You know, many of you guys may have missed them on Sundays because they're traveling around soliciting other churches to help what we should totally be able to do. So I know they're looking forward to it. They're ready to get there in February. We just need to help them along. So thanks so much for everything that you guys have already done. Thank you for the tools. Thank you for everything that we were able to help do, because the way that you guys helped support this trip was absolutely a blessing to what we were able to accomplish. So thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.